Hello and welcome to Crosstalk. I'm Peter Lavelle. The euro, a currency in crisis in an unknown future. But is there a silver lining? Okay, let's determine if there is a silver lining to the euro crisis.
Are we on already?
And I'm joined by Jeffrey Sommers. He's an associate professor at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. Also, we have Michael Hudson. He is president of the Institute for the Study of Long-Term Economic Trends. And Matthew Lynn. He's a financial journalist. Okay, gentlemen, this is Crosstalk. That means you can jump in anytime you want. I'm going to be very contrarian. We hear all through the media that the obituary for the euro has already been written. We're waiting for the funeral, okay? Let's turn it all upside down. Let's take a look at some virtue out of tragedy. Number one, this crisis could actually create a real European central bank. It has limited tools now. Now give it a lot of tools. What do you think about that, guys? Matthew first. Just empower it.
Absolutely. I mean, well, then the next thing they're going to do, I mean, you're absolutely right at the beginning, the euro is in deep, deep trouble and they're going to have to do something to try and save it. And I think they will. I mean, the amount of political capital which the entire generation of European leaders have put into this project means that whatever they can do, they will do. So, I mean, the next step they're going to do is they're going to do common euro bonds. They're going to try and have a single fiscal authority for Europe. And, yeah, they'll give the ECB a lot more power to go out and buy bonds in the market. Whether that's a good thing is much more debatable. Whether that's actually going to work, I don't think it will work.
But it will be a step. I mean, it needs political will to do it. But if you're going to keep the euro, go all the way. Because what we've seen over the last 2 years, particularly the last few months, is just half measures. We have lack of political leadership. No one really wants to make a political move. But that's what is necessary, political leadership now.
There's a false way of looking at the problem so far. Of course Europe should have a central bank that can create credit. Commercial banks create credit all the time on a computer keyboard. The central banks were founded to create credit to fund government deficits. That's why the Bank of England was founded. That's why the Federal Reserve was founded. But the banking interests in Europe crippled the central bank. They didn't want a central bank to create credit. They say, we want governments to come to us and pay us interest, and we want to rip off the economy. Don't have a central bank. Don't have a public option. Let us raise your cost of doing business. Give us the business. So, of course, there should be a central bank. Unfortunately, the way in which you just mentioned the central bank to be perform a function is what it looks like it'll be. The central bank is not to create employment, not to run a government deficit, not to help the people, but to give more money to the banks to bail them out. That is rotten. That is central bank lobbyists, and that shouldn't happen. And if that's how they create a central bank, then good for the Europeans for saying to hell with Angela Merkel.
Okay, Jeffrey, go ahead.
Well, I have to concur with Michael on this. I mean, I think essentially what we see is continued rent-seeking. Ever since the Lisbon agreement and treaty, what we've seen is, and really going back to Maastricht, is an attempt to liberalize and to privatize credit creation. So we have this rent-seeking from the real economy to the financial sector, and I don't see things changing. Now, I think all of this, to a certain extent, is just foam on the water. The real problem, the underlying structural problem that has not been fixed is, how do you really recycle capital through the system from rich countries to poor countries? And how do you do that in a way?
But that was not.
Keynes?
But that wasn't the purpose of the Eurozone.
Of course, it wasn't.
But should it be now?
Absolutely. We need to go back to Keynes, and we need to understand that in order to have any kind of meaningful either international trade or real European-wide trade, you need national development or regional development.
Okay, well, you guys are jumping ahead of me, Michael. You want to jump in?
We
need to have fiscal unity. We have to have one fiscal policy for the entire Eurozone. That's the only way that's going to happen. Should that happen?
Jeff used the word rent-seeking, and your audience may not be familiar with that because it's a technical term. Rent-seeking means get a free lunch for privilege. Right now, commercial banks can create credit on a keyboard, and they say, let us do it, we're responsible. But if a government does it, they said, look at 1921. 1921 and the hyperinflation happened because of German reparations and inter-Allied debts. It was international. The Europeans have let the commercial bank lobbyists shape the discussion into a kind of fictitious, don't look here, let us make a whole killing off the government deficit.
Okay, that's what it means. Go ahead, jump in.
But with respect, I mean, I take your analysis, and I think there's a lot in it. But I think you're giving it too much of an American perspective. You're talking about a lot of the problems that I think the world economy in general has a problem with its financial sector and its banking sector, and that's true pretty much wherever you look. That's true in the Eurozone. That's true in the UK. That's true in the United States. But there's particular problems in the Eurozone, which is that the currency has been put together in a dysfunctional way, and it doesn't work. And it's not particularly a problem about commercial banks ripping off the rest of the population. That may be going on as it goes on in the rest of the world. I mean, it's a problem about the fact that the currency itself is dysfunctional, that these economies are not convergent, that you have too much debt in the peripheral countries, the trade balances and the industrial development is unequal in the different countries, and the money
has to be recycled.
But
gentlemen, will fiscal unity fix that?
Fiscal unity is run by the banking sector. You will have the most right-wing government. You will turn Europe into a banana republic if you have fiscal unity run like Ecuador and like a banana republic.
Michael, if you want to empower the central bank, isn't it better to have fiscal unity?
Here's the problem. The central bankers are brainwashed with tunnel vision to do what's good for the commercial bankers. And if you have a central bank who wants to screw the economy to help the commercial banks, then you don't want them to have power. You want to take them out in the backyard and very politely say, there's nothing personal, but we've got to shoot you.
It'll be very personal, Jeffrey.
Just getting back to Matthew's point, he actually inadvertently returned to my point, which is that we have this divergent development. You're absolutely right, between the South and the North for the most part. And the only way that you're going to address that is to figure out how you're going to meaningfully develop.
You just hit the point that I wanted to go to, and it's called Thatcherism on the Mediterranean.
Exactly.
Okay?
Right. They thought they could solve this problem by just ignoring it, by looking the other way and have Germany and France and the Scandinavian countries dump their surpluses into the South, maintain reasonable levels of employment, and that somehow they would eventually be able to repay the debts that were taken on to purchase all of
this. How do you get there? Matthew, if I can go to you. Okay. Thatcherism on the Mediterranean. I think we all would agree with that here. But I don't know what the time frame would be, a decade, 2 decades. But you would have a slippery slope right there. You would have, okay, fine, over the next 20 years, you're going to help us clean up our debt, our infrastructure issues. Can you change their cultural attitudes? I mean, I agree with that. It gives a time frame for the Mediterranean countries to get their act together. But should someone be paying for that?
Well, it's kind of a facile point. You can say, okay, you need the Greek economy's structural reform. Of course it needs structural reform. Anyone can see that. That's been true for a long time. Pretty much anyone in Greece can see it. You can't do it at a time when you have an economy contracting at 6 or 7% a year. It's just impossible. I mean, I grew up in the UK when we had real Thatcherism, the original version. And it wasn't that much fun, but it did the economy a lot of good. But the economy wasn't contracting. You had a couple of years where the economy was contracting a bit, but on the whole, the economy was expanding quite fast.
I thought you only had Thatcherism under Tony Blair.
Well, we carried on a bit for a long time, and we still have it. We like it in a funny kind of a way. But my point is, you can't have Thatcherism. You can't have that kind of structural reform in an economy that's shrinking at 6%, 7% a year. I just think it's impossible. It's too much to ask of a population. You can have it in an economy that's growing 2-3% a year. It's still a big ask. It's tough for people. People lose their jobs. People have to change the kind of work that they're doing. Industries have to change. It's very difficult. It's easy to sit around a TV studio and say you have structural reform. It's actually hard on the ground. But to have it in that kind of intense contraction, it's just bonkers. It's not going to work.
Matthew's point is a good one, though, again, about divergent development. But the problem is that unlike England, you can't have all of East and Southern Europe turn into an offshore financial zone, which essentially London was, and London drove the UK's economy. So it's a fallacy to suggest that you can spread this model. You can't. It's a beggar thy neighbor policy, and the UK has been very good at it. London has been exceptional at it, but not everyone can do it. The other problem that you have with Southern Europe is that actually, in terms of the percentage of GDP, the rates of taxes collected are exceedingly low, unlike Northern Europe. So this is where we actually need the reform. I mean, Greece, in some respects, is far more democratic than the United States. In the United States, only rich people avoid taxes. In Greece, it's everyone. So this is what we have to stop. And then Spain as well.
Well, all these problems, Greece, Spain, Portugal, these all used to be dictatorships. And the dictatorships left a legacy of not taxing the rich. Now, you made the very good point. Look, we're in a recession now. You'd think that for any civilized country, not Europe, but America or Latin America or Africa, for a civilized area, they would say with a recession, you would want to have the central bank create credit to run a deficit, to build infrastructure, and have employment. But in Europe, they say, no, you have a a recession, give more money to the banks. We caused the recession. Now, you give us the money, and by the way, we know you don't have it. Let's sell off the Parthenon, sell off the water systems, privatize everything, and let us rip you off all over again. Now is time for the big ripoff, and that's what their idea of a central bank is, and this is wrong, and it's evil, and the European voters see this. In America, 85% of the voters opposed the bailout to the banks in 2008. And similarly in Europe, the
reason... Do the average American, does the average American have a lobbyist in Congress?
No, but the Republicans in Congress knew that the polls were so negative that they couldn't get elected if they ended up as shills for the bank. In Europe, the population is so deadened by your rotten bankers in Europe and your rotten media here that they actually, the banks think they can do whatever they want. And the voters are smart enough to say, well, we can't have a referendum like they had in Iceland over whether to bail out the banks. The only way we can do is throw Angela Merkel out. And if they had a real election over this and say, let's have the, if you're going
okay,
to push
Mike, we'll
the
talk a little bit more about Angela Merkel when we get after the break. After the break, we'll continue our discussion on what to do with the euro. Stay with RT.
Well, when one deals with warfare, it has to realize that there's tremendous amounts of damage that are done, not just human damage, but damage to the physical environment in which the battlefield takes place. Tremendous amounts of damage are done by aerial bombs, by napalm, by chemicals that are used.
Whether it's sonic booms affecting marine mammals, or it's the burning oil fields in Iraq, or it's destroyed coral reefs in the Pacific for landing purposes, the list just goes on and on.
The Geneva Conventions of 1949 states that care shall be taken in war to protect the environment against widespread, long-term, and severe damage. The United States, although it has accepted almost all of the provisions of Protocol 1, has taken exception to that one.
More news today. Violence has once again flared up.
These are the images the world has been seeing from the streets of Canada.
Giant corporations rule the day.
Welcome to the future. Bringing you the latest in science and technology from around Russia. We've got the future covered.
Welcome back to Crosstalk. I'm Peter Lavelle. To remind you, we're talking about the fate of the euro. All right, gentlemen, we've talked a lot about finance and banking. Let's talk about the political angle of this. How is this euro crisis affecting political discourse? Do the extremes, and let's look at the left first. I mean, the leftist party, a lot of the steam been taken out of their wins because of what austerity is supposed to mean, or does it energize them? What do you think, Matthew?
Well, I mean, you know, the key political problem is that what needs to happen economically is to have a much more powerful European Central Bank and have a common fiscal policy, but there's no political support for it. So leaders are absolutely stuck. They, you know, you can sit there with your economic advisor and say,
so
you need to do
you're
X.
You're saying it's necessary, but it's politically an impossible.
Yeah, it's politically it's not politically desirable because there's no political control. There's no common, you know, European political culture. You know, in the United States, you have, you know, a common country, you have a common language, you have a common media. I mean, people vote
insight on the issues. I'm sure Americans, you'll make lots of criticisms, as I would of the UK, of the political system. But it's, you know, it's roughly speaking a functioning democracy, whereas Europe just isn't. There is no mechanism by which, for example, the European Central Bank or a European Treasury Ministry, a European Finance Ministry setting common fiscal and tax policies can have any kind of democratic legitimacy.
There needs to be more consensus here, but as this crisis continues, there's less consensus because the Germans will say, hey, we've done enough, more than our fair share. But what is really necessary is for some kind of political consensus. I'm going to stay away from union right now. We can get that there later. But there has to be a political consensus. Jeff, is that possible right now? Because it seems the inclination is to go in reverse.
Well, the problem's even worse yet. I mean, unfortunately, the Social Democrats, whether it's in Germany or in any other European Union country, operate under Thatcher's maxim that there is no alternative. They're not acting as Social Democrats, and they're not imagining any different policy. Moreover, when the public actually does begin to engage these issues, they're charged with acting in populist ways. I mean, they're just absolutely dismissed. The level of arrogance by policymakers on this particular issue is extreme. And it's not even permitting any kind of meaningful debate to take place. The discourse is at a very low level.
What do you think about that?
This is exactly the problem. Imagine 100 years ago, nobody could imagine that the Social Democratic and the Labour parties are now to the right of the Conservatives. Yeah. The left wing is now the right wing. It's the left wing parties that have led the fight for privatization and to turn over power to the banks. And it's as if they've somehow been taken over by the banking sectors and they're socialist in name only. We used to call them fascists in America.
If I can just interject with one more follow-up point. What it's resulted in, both in the United States and in much of Europe, is to confuse the electorate massively. So, for instance, the United States, President Barack Obama, who I actually voted for and gave money to, has acted in a very center-right, even right-wing fashion when it comes to finance. What's happened with the electorate is, because he's often charged with being a leftist by Murdoch media, they assume that he's very left, so now they need to go very far right. And that's why I think you see this oscillation back and forth within European Union countries between social democratic governments and conservative governments. The electorate is just terribly confused, and they just don't see an alternative.
Well, you know, I remember watching a report about a woman in Iceland that had a wonderful small business of her own. She made designer clothes, specific tailored clothing. And then she, during the crisis in Iceland, she suddenly woke up and found out she was bankrupt, and she didn't do anything wrong at all. As a matter of fact, she did everything that she was told to do. What I'm getting at here is that understanding this crisis and how we got to it, because I think what Michael's getting right here is more like banking fascism here, but it's been taken completely out of the economy. This is not an economic crisis. It is a banking crisis. It's a financial crisis, and how the European currency, the euro, fits into it.
Well, I slightly disagree with the perspective here. I mean, I think what confuses people is you had, you know, the financial crash of 2008, and you had the credit crunch and all that kind of stuff, which was a global problem. And then you have the euro, which kind of came along soon afterwards, about 2009. And because they happen to happen at the same time, people sort of think they're the same problem, but they're not really. I think regardless of whether you had the credit crunch or the financial crash of 2008, I think the euro, because it's a dysfunctional currency, because it was badly designed, would have created all of these problems. I don't really agree that there's same problem. The only way they were really linked was because you had a massive increase in budget deficits to deal with the financial crash, which kind of accelerated the problems in the Eurozone. But I really think I think they're different problems, and I think you have to analyze them separately. Just on your political point, I mean, I think, you know, one of the big worries about the euro crisis is that it opens up to really quite unpleasant far-right parties, because nobody in the mainstream, because because it's so dysfunctional, because it's a bit like the gold standard in the 1930s that was creating massive deflationary forces and austerity, which opened up a lot of opportunities for the right. And in some degree, the same thing is happening. You see it in Finland with the True Finns. I mean, they're not a fascist party, but they are a nationalist party. Marine Le Pen in France is the only mainstream voice.
Well, you
picked me up. But I mean, she's on 23% of the vote.
You know,
it's 23% of the vote.
Well, who would have thought Le Pen would be mainstream?
But she's not mainstream in the sense of acceptable views. But the crisis is making very right-wing parties, you know, allowing them into the mainstream. And that's quite worrying. And it's one of the aspects in which it's a bad
Michael,
idea.
Michael, you want to go first?
Your point about Iceland is absolutely correct. Look at the situation where the social democratic government of Iceland, the prime minister, wanted to repay all the bank debt, making Iceland bankrupt for 50 years, turning Iceland into what Ireland became. The president, who only has a function of signing off, said, if you're going to bankrupt the country for 50 years, there should be a vote. 90% of the people opposed what the social democratic government is doing because they didn't want to all be plunged into the bankruptcy that you've just described. She tried to do it all over again, and again was rejected. Now, this is, in a nutshell, what happens with a central bank, because you're told in Europe the big lie that an independent central bank is the hallmark of democracy. But an independent central bank, nobody votes for them. It's
exactly.
Controlled by the oligarchy. It means drop your democracy, let's have an oligarchy. That's what an independent central bank means. And as long as you have a central bank run by right-wing bankers who will say, we want to bring in an anti-labor economist, like the lady in France who's head of the IMF, and we want to be anti-democratic, anti-labor, and you say that's the hallmark of democracy, then how on earth are you ever going to have a civilized discussion?
Jeff, democracy in the euro. Is it a toxic mix?
Very much so. Yeah. I mean, essentially, we're dealing with a neo version of Plato's Republic being played out in central banks. I mean, it's absolutely terrible. There is no democracy. But just to follow up on a point that you made, you know, I would argue that there is a real structural dimension to this crisis. In other words, financialization has starved the real economy of capital and entrepreneurial energies that would have gone into innovation previously. And as a consequence of that, we're not seeing the deployment of as many innovative technologies as we perhaps would have in the past, nor the development of them. So I think that you're right. To a certain extent, it's a false crisis, but on a deeper level, there is some real dimension to it as well.
Okay. You want to jump in there?
Yeah, no, I mean, I agree. I mean, I think you have a general global problem of a financially dominant, financial services and banking sector, you know, but I mean, that's true everywhere. But I come back to what I said earlier. I think the euro as a currency, you know, is kind of quite similar to the way, you know, the sort of rather half-hearted gold standard of the early 1930s was working, in that it imposed, you know, severely deflationary policies on countries that couldn't survive it. And I do think that's a separate issue.
Mike, why do you hate Angela Merkel so much?
I don't hate her. It's the fact that
you've been beating her up all through the program.
She has bought the banking myth. She says we have to give money to the banks and make them solvent. If they lose all the money in a bad debt, make them good. You've used the word financialization. She doesn't. She thinks that the economy needs bankers to run it in to make it work. But the banker's product is debt. And the reason we're in a crisis is it's a debt crisis because the bankers have created debt irresponsibly. She says it's not the government to tell banks to be productive. Be parasitic. That's the free market. Rip us off. Hey, that's the free market. Our job is to give the bankers enough money so that when they make bad loans, they can do everything. They get paid, and we're willing to sacrifice the economy year after year. We're willing to sell it out. So what Merkel is an American politician. She can deliver her constituency to her campaign control. And if that's the kind of politics you have in Europe, then
the Americanization of the Eurozone.
Yes, and referring to old Europe the way he does.
I mean, just jump in there. I mean, you're absolutely right on one point, which is that they're far too scared of the losses that the European banks would suffer. For example, it's obvious to anyone that Greece should default on its debt. Greece has 170% of GDP. It has an economy contracting at 7% a year. There's absolutely no way it could begin to repay its debt. And actually, if you talk to the people who now own the bonds, who are mostly kind of hedge funds, and they know they're not going to get repaid at 100% on the euro. They know that they'd be lucky to get 50 cents on the euro, and they're settled for something like that. But they're so scared of the losses showing up at SocGen and BNP and Deutsche Bank and the rest of it that they don't allow it to happen. And it would be much better for everyone if they allowed the peripheral countries to default. And then if they need to rescue Deutsche Bank, I mean, you could have a debate about that afterwards. And if you need to, then rescue it.
I wonder if there'd be a vote on that.
But at least do it in an open way. Where everything's above board and everyone can see the figures. It'd be much better.
You know, we have the same issue with Sweden and Latvia. And of course, the Swedish banks were terrified, as was the Swedish government, the Latvians would default. And I think you're absolutely right, Matthew. We need a debt write-down. We have to stop maintaining this fiction that these debts are repayable. They're not.
But just take a huge care cut. Everybody?
No, the public would not.
Cancel. All right.
Just cancel it.
The public would actually benefit from this. So the banks would take a haircut. But just to get back to a point Michael made, I mean, I think what he was describing was a kind of a functional outcome of the system. I mean, Michael has used an analogy or metaphor before that I rather like, and that is of a parasite that actually convinces its host to act in ways that it wants. And so we have this ideology that's present. And that's how this system runs in a very parasitic fashion. You have economists who actually control intellectual production, and politicians pick up on that. And I think many of them think they actually are acting in the public interest.
So where Jeff and I disagree with the Europeans is that we're free marketers. We believe in what Adam Smith said. Adam Smith said that no government has ever repaid its debt. And he was right, and we believe that. And there's the pretense that governments can repay the debts. The banks know very well that they can't repay the debts. What they want is now foreclosure time has arrived. Oh, you can't pay? Give us the Parthenon. Give us your water supply. Give us your tourist land. This is the big grab. And that's finance is now doing what military
warfare
used to do.
Yeah, but isn't that kind of finance, Matthew, if I give you the last word, is that kind of finance destroying the real economy?
Well, certainly within the Eurozone, I mean, the insistence that peripheral countries can repay their debt is absolutely catastrophic for these economies. I mean, I think, you know, people just need to look at the figures of what's happening in places like Greece, and that's just the most extreme example. The same thing's happening in Italy and Portugal and Spain. You know, we've seen recessions in the UK and the United States, but this is a 1930s-style Dust Bowl recession that's being inflicted on these countries, and it's completely crazy.
All right, gentlemen. Gentlemen, we've all ended on a very pessimistic note. Always happens when we discuss the euro. I want to thank my guests here attending the Global Policy Forum here in Yaroslava. Thank you very much. And thanks to our viewers for watching us here at RT. See you next time. And remember, crosstalk rules.